Bryce Alexander, and from Microsoft, obviously. And today I wanted to talk about data completeness audit, why it's important, and how that approach. Let's start with why. What do we need? In a typical example, you have a producer after a few with hello consumer destination, and later just load through. But in our case, rather than big data, we actually have more than one destination, and we have a lot of producers. The entire traffic cluster is also more than a single machine, so everything of that can introduce some latencies, delays, and possible data losses, so not all the data make its way to destination in time.
How much is our data?
Here I'm talking only about monetized data, and it's 100 kbps, 300 GB per hour, approximately. And every bit of this data equals money. Every lost data is lost money. So we need to audit it. How we did it before? Just plug in Elasticsearch cluster in the middle. And every producer sends produced audits, and every uploader sends uploaded audits. And Elasticsearch serves as an all-in-one engine, aggregates all discounts, allows for command and share, which are useful. And it's also sort of an important endpoint for consumers to figure out how many bytes were produced, uploaded, compare those metrics, make a decision whether it can proceed or not. And it was a little bit inconvenient, doesn't have to write query, calculate results on your own. Even though Elasticsearch is a scalable engine, doesn't scale well when data grows as fast as in our case. So we can, it scales horizontally, but we need to reshut indices all the time, and all the processing time is proportional to the data, which is not really good. And it requires special handling of incrementing report counts, which I'll talk later about. So our new approach was to develop a new service, which starts with front-end web service, which accepts all the audits produced and uploaded, and immediately it saves it into Kafka. It ensures high availability, so none of the producers or destinations hang up trying to deliver this audit message, and they already deliver the data. Next, it gets processed by Spark pipeline. It pre-aggregates data to one in chunks, and also keeps track of duplicates and all this increment. Then we use Elasticsearch again, but much smaller instance, because now we don't have to store all these millions and millions of records, but just a single record per minute. And on the other end, we have data analysis with service, which allows end customers to query with a single request how much data was produced and uploaded per location. And in case you read some loss, you're able to figure out which file is missing, which is important for debugging. Let's talk about challenges. Basically, we need high availability and disaster recovery, and we run on Autopilot. Autopilot is our internal framework, which not only manages machines, but also introduces a chaos monkey, which basically brings machines down randomly sometimes to make sure your service is reliable before the real disaster. It is a small disaster anyways. In fact, we need two of these pipelines in parallel. And the Spark pipeline also requires some tuning. So what happens inside is the cluster manager, which starts drivers, they communicate with working nodes.
And Spark does a good job of handling working nodes. They're going down, it's
fine. But the driver is a single instance. So we configured this in a supervised mode. Our cluster manager always keeps track of driver, and if it dies, it just adds a new instance. So now cluster manager is the weakest link. And we configured this as a multiple instance with Zookeeper. Fortunately, Spark allows for it out of the box. Now it's a rock solid piece. So footprint. We used to have 34 data nodes for Elasticsearch in two data centers. And whopping 15 master nodes, which are pretty much doing nothing. And they're scattered across three data centers, which totals in 49 machines in 3 DCs. And the current limitation is avoiding new streams will require adding much more nodes, changing configuration, deploying this Elasticsearch cluster. With the Spark solution, we have a little bit more machines. We're using 40 executors, 6 machines for high availability, 16 Kafka machines for transient storage, and just 10 Elasticsearch machines for aggregated storage. Total is a little bit more, 72 machines, but in just two data centers. We don't need a third Joe Spring Brain anymore. And the system is ready to onboard much, much more data volumes than we have now. So, what kind of metadata we use in this audits? It's a simple message. In fact, it's not in JSON format, it's in our internal bond, but just to give you an idea. We have an action type, which is either previewed or uploaded. Action timestamp is basically UGC now when this event was created. We also have some supplemental fields to allow for debugging, such as environment and machine name. And environment in our terms is just a cluster name. Then we have stream ID, which specifies the type of the data, which maps to the topic name of the Kafka under audit. We have source ID, which indicates the source where this particular records are sourced from. For example, file name. And page ID. We need this because sometimes they are large, and it's one message, so it's batched, and each batch needs to have its own ID. We also carry size and bytes and number of records. And in case of uploaded, we have a destination name where it has been uploaded to. This is how end result looks like. In the green line, we see the produced metrics, which lines up perfectly fine with everything until a certain point. And then you can see that upload location 8 is from behind, and upload location 11 is also a little bit behind the very end. By this, you can judge basically how much of your data is lost, and can you proceed with processing, or you should wait until all this destination got up and have all your information inside. So, small example. We have a producer, our Kafka pipeline, and just for simplicity's sake, a single destination and an audit system. Producer writes file 1. And on the same producer box, we actually have a separate service which scans all those files written and sends produced audits. Let's say server has written 3 reports. Immediately, service wakes up and realizes, okay, we have new 3 reports, 24 bytes, current timestamp is this. This is file one. And the batch ID is calculated as a hash of all the records in this batch. So let's say it's ABC93. This information gets sent to the appropriate destination. Well, the system figures out that we have produced three records. Now, two more records have been written, and even though records 1, 2, 3 have been transmitted to the Kafka, they still remain in the file. So our current produced is 40 bytes and 5 records. And this is exactly the incrementing metrics we shared talking about in the beginning. Just because we might have a lot of duplicates, not a lot, but at least some of them, due to Kafka replay scenarios, and since it's a crucial audit system, I want to make sure that the audit message has been delivered, so sometimes we don't get ACK back from the audit system and we push a second produced or audit message. So it introduces some duplicates and drag of what the real size is. So these sizes are incremental. And it says new batch ID. And goes to Kafka and to the system. Now we have five records. Now when we upload it to the destination one, we also created this uploaded audit. We said we uploaded three records, this is the upload timestamp, we calculate by batch ID, and we specify it has been uploaded to destination one. And this data goes. By batch ID we are able to mine with A. These three reports actually belong to file one. Now, in our system, we have information that we have produced five reports, but ordered only three. And if you need, for example, 95% of the data to begin processing on your destination one, it's clear that you have to wait until at least two more reports arrive in this case. But in real world, it's big data. And not a few records. Also, I want to mention that we don't use it yet, but I also think about sample auditing, which means not every batch will be audited. Because as an SML example, the data volumes are like hundreds and thousands times bigger than that. We can sustain that much volume of audit information in this system. So for sample auditing, let's say we will every 10th or every 15th record will be marked as audit and produced. Audits will be sent only for those records. And upon reception to destination, the system will look into header and say, okay, this record is marked for audit. So it will generate produced records only for them as well. It's not in production yet, only idea board. Huge data sets. So, version of software we used in the setup for Kafka under audit is 0.8.1. For all the Broad Elasticsearch, we're using 1.2. And for newer Broad, we use the same Kafka version, which has proven its reliability. Spark 1.4 and Elasticsearch 1.7. Another one thing worth mentioning is we have an open position, so if you are passionate about big data and fancy processing, near real-time processing, we'll be to send our send to go, as you know. We did all in Microsoft together. Yeah, that's correct.
The auditing system requires exactly what's matching.
Yes.
So how many
codes? We match by batch IDs, which is basically a hash of the batch in terms of record. So if we see the same batch ID arrive twice, No, it's a duplicate and a discovery.
And on the auditing side, also you have multiple, like you have been waiting for multiple events, then, and then you also want it on the auditing side. So your composition Kafka has the audit side to audit.
Yes, and the Spark job handles this duplicates as well.
Cool, any other question? All right, thanks, Alex.